Hello, and welcome to the Poisons and Pestilence podcast, and our first ever movie review special. In these specials, I will take a wander through well-known films and TV shows, which deal with topics related to chemical and biological weapons. And each time, I will be joined by a specialist who seeks to balance the love of film with technical pedantry. The conversation in the movie specials is unscripted and free-flowing, and so if you think we've missed anything, or if one of us, most likely me, have been off the mark on anything, do let me know. In this maiden episode, I chat with the epidemiologist Dr. Saskia Popescu, who speaks, naturally, in a personal capacity. And if you notice the production value of this episode is slightly higher than normal, that's because I've had help from the wonderful Nicolas Lureau, who is talented, creative, and very encouraging as an audio engineer and producer, and his details can be found in the show notes. And with that, all that is left for me to say is to sit back, relax, and enjoy this, whatever this is. So, Saskia, thank you very much for coming on today, in particular because we're trying a new format, which is, to be frank, I think it's probably against all of our better judgments. So maybe a lot of people who work on chemical, biological or related public health stuff, not an aspersion, but we're often nerds and we often like films. And strangely, we seem compelled to watch films that very often at some level are going to make us want to write angry emails, which I don't know where that comes from in the human psyche. I mean, do you have any insights on why we do this to ourselves?
No, and as a person who writes those angry emails, but I also write nice ones too. So if someone gets something right, I do feel it's important to send the nice email because I don't want to just send bad emails. But I would love to know why.
Yeah, and I bet it's really hard to frame that language of how do you come across as being gently encouraging and not kind of like, when you're talking about that specific subvariant of the virus, did you know the whole brain doesn't actually melt? Because that, I think, is always going to put people on edge as they receive that in their sort of fan mail inbox.
Yeah, it's tough. And it's weird, I think, especially when you watch it, when you watch films like that, because we love them, with people who also do what you do and then with people who don't. And yeah, I think I love them, actually. I don't actually get mad about how wrong they are anymore. For some reason, I actually get more upset about bad bioweapons plots in films than I do about outbreak response. It's really bizarre. I don't know why that is. So if you know any psyche behind that, I would greatly appreciate it.
Maybe this is will be one of the main insights we get from the series, is we can definitely give practical advice on... Yeah, basically a diagnosis. I think that's probably right. So let's start with a bit about you. So I interact with you a lot on social media, and I know that you've been through, is it the biodefense training school originally? Were you an alma mater of that?
Out of George Mason? Yes, I did my PhD. Yeah, Greg Koblenz was my PhD advisor and still one of my biggest mentors, and love him. Poor man, I put him through the ringer as my dissertation chair.
As it should be. But yeah, and so you've kind of worked on lots of different roles around sort of the area of biodefense, is that right? So what kind of roles of you? What's your current role? Sorry.
Yeah. So I'm currently a senior fellow at the Council on Strategic Risks, and I am a assistant professor at the University of Maryland in their EPI program. So I'm basically a giant nerd, is the way I like to describe myself. If it's an infectious disease, I'm super curious about it.
And so, if you were going to be cast in a, let's say, high budget sci-fi film related to, I don't know, sort of a man-made pandemic, how do you think you would be cast in that film? What would the character look like, do you think?
I mean, I love all of the Epis in Contagion because they're so good and they're very reasonable. And yeah, I love the way that they portrayed them. But then I keep thinking of like World War Z, where there's the virologist who accidentally killed himself at the beginning. And you're like, well, guess we're shit out of luck here. And who's just like running towards the situation. I think I would be that person that is super curious, but also highly cognizant of the security risks involved. So in the middle, my joke is always that we're the first ones to die in an outbreak or a zombie movie because we're constantly running towards the infectious disease. And as an infectious disease epi, I worked in healthcare for a long time doing infection prevention and biopreparedness in hospitals. We were there. So I worked in frontline healthcare response until about September, October of 2020. And then I actually went to Netflix and helped run their global COVID response and global health response for Mpox later on and everything. And, you know, now I've kind of gone back to my biodefense roots. So full disclosure for you and for anyone listening, I am a massive infectious disease nerd, a massive film nerd, and got to work in the industry for 2.5 years. And my partner is also in the industry. So we are a household that loves film and bad films, especially.
It's funny. So I think with speaking to people that I know, I think it tends to be Ian Malcolm out of Jurassic Park tends to be the natural people that people ideally, that's the one they want to be portrayed as.
Yeah.
But I think in reality, we probably wouldn't be. He is so cool. And like, he does a little thing with the hand, and it's all like, life finds a way.
And like the low buttoned shirt and the leather jacket. I wish it was that cool.
I always forget how attractive he was sort of late night. I'm sure he still is, I'm sure. But I mean, in that he was at the heat, it was kind of peak nerd hotness, wasn't it? And that continued, of course, to Independence Day. Great film. But anyway, this is not about rating stars based on their attractiveness. We're going to do Outbreak. Now, got a confession. Outbreak, I had seen at some point in the mid-2000s, forgotten I'd watched it, and then rewatched this about 2 weeks ago when I found out we were going to be you were going to be coming on the show.
In a remote African jungle, a small monkey is captured. Bound for a pet store in America, the animal carries a deadly virus.
Now, I know that some of us have doubts about what we're about to do. We'd be less than human if we didn't. But the fate of the nation, perhaps the world, is in our hands. We cannot, we dare not refuse this burden. I'm confident that each of you will do his duty. God forgive us.
Your town is being quarantined.
We got 19 dead. We got 100 more infected. It's spreading like a brush fire.
What are you talking about?
If one of them's got it, then 10 of them have got it now. And if one of them gets out of Cedar Creek, we have a very interesting problem.
If that bug gets out of there, 260 million Americans will be dead or dying.
I'm leaving with the team in an hour.
From the heart of a small California town.
Damn it, Sam. I want to save these people, same as you.
To the inner circle of power in Washington.
The most optimistic projection for the spread of the virus is this. 24 hours... 36 hours, 48 hours.
The greatest medical crisis of all time.
We can't stop it.
Begins.
Try to remain calm.
Many people are dying and are going to continue to die unless we find this monkey.
There will be panic the likes of which we have never seen.
Portland residents of San Diego,
residents of Atlanta,
Denver residents of Detroit,
and Dallas residents. I love that film. I had a great time.
I love it. I actually read The Hot Zone when I was young. I think I was like 7 or 8. My stepmom was reading it on vacation and handed it to me, and I read it not really understanding, but just being like, "What? This is the coolest thing ever!" And diseases do this, and then my uncle spent the entire time explaining microorganisms to me and disinfection and sterilization, which to this day still is like crazy. But you will find a lot of people in the field read it, and it sounds horrible because it's such an inaccurate, dramatized account of Ebola, but it inspired so many people to get into it. And then you see like the film version of it, which is so bad, it's good. And I rewatched it recently. It's been a few years. Kind of like, oh my God, it's so painful, but it's so delightful. And you know, watching it with my partner who doesn't work in that, but was actually looking at the stunt side of it, was like, oh my God, they actually did this. This is really dangerous. I'm like, that's nice that you see that part of it.
So my thing is, so I just recently discovered the TV Tropes website, which is, it's amazing. And you go through, it's done a lot of the kind of, it goes through and identifies the kind of common cheesy aspects of films. And as you might imagine, Outbreak, like, it ticks them all. And I think it's very telling, because when people are asked, you know, what's their favorite line, you get four or five responses. There is definitely different parts of that that appeal to people. But that film starts with like a scene where they're bombing an area, the monkey survives, and then that monkey is carrying some sort of disease. The monkey. That monkey plays a very important role in the film, and I think it's underrated. He wasn't actually nominated for an Oscar as part of that, but I think he should have been given greater credit, because I think the monkey is sort of, you know, he had
an important character acting. A lot of character acting. And it's especially, I don't know, I mean, I will say this, it's impressive that he was playing a monkey in Africa despite being a species that is in South America. So mad props for that character acting.
I mean, of course, we don't want to get into that. It's not a controversial show, but of course, you know, this part of this sort of encouragement of monkey diversity was something that was very big in the late 1990s. And I think that's probably part of the reason he was cast in it, in a kind of, you know, fingers up to typecasting based on monkey species. I've got a few questions, okay? And I'm not asking these because I know the answer. I'm asking them because I don't understand which bits of it, where the kernel of truth is and where it isn't in some of these things. Okay.
Okay.
So at some point, there's Dustin Hoffman doing Dustin Hoffman things, doing a lot of hand waving, where it all of a sudden turns to finding the original monkey that came over on this plane and then bit someone and then or was spat in their mouth or something. Either way, this monkey comes over to America, where, of course, you know, that's where a pandemic would start, obviously, not just for film reasons, but because, of course, it would. Monkey comes over, monkey carrying crazy-ass disease.
Naturally, yeah.
And then the disease spreads, and then you bite someone, gets spat at, you get secondary infections, and so on and so on. For some reason, they're really interested in catching this monkey. The monkey of non-determinant species origin, who doesn't conform to national stereotypes about where baby monkeys of that type should come from. Why were they, would we do that? What would the advantage being of catching, is it monkey zero? Why were they looking for that monkey? Would that make sense?
It's super interesting to me. And I first and foremost would always defer to the smarter people in the space, which are the virologists and the evolutionary biologists who really track this down. But I think what's fascinating is that this monkey is supposed to be the host animal, right? And they're trying to capture it to develop a serum, which, don't even get me started on the timeline of suddenly catching the host and being able to develop the serum. But that's the plot line, essentially, which is really fascinating because that's not how it works. I mean, when we're trying to sample animals, it's to understand viral evolution and understand the origin of a pathogen, not develop treatment modalities. What I think is really interesting, though, is this monkey is supposed to be the host, which means he doesn't experience illness from it. But he also then has two strains of the virus in him, which happens. Okay, he can have the super infection. All right, so he's got the original, I think they call it Motaba. He's got the original Motaba, and then like the Cedar Creek Motaba. Right, Motaba. Yeah, he's got both, which is, all right, that happens. You can have a super infection. You know, that's what drives recombination, resortment. Cool. But that doesn't mean you just get to kind of like spread one and then spread the other and just dabble about in spreading each, because that's what he did basically. And it's so confusing how that happened, because I was going through this, I was thinking about this weird timeline of like, okay, he gives Jimbo the original, and then Jimbo's girlfriend gets it and they have the original strain, but then he gives it to the monkey in the pet shop, and then the pet shop upper, and then it goes, you know, into Cedar Creek. But we know that the, you know, kind of reassortment and this viral mutation happens when it becomes airborne in Cedar Creek, which is a whole thing that if you want to enrage anyone who works in these diseases, you just bring up that piece, because I have never seen virologists or just people that work in infectious disease get so annoyed by this particular film. It's really impressive because it's just so bad. But I think that's the most interesting part to me, is not just that they're like, we're going to catch the monkey and it's going to give us a cure, and we're going to make the cure 15 minutes flat. Cool. But also that this monkey is like, the whole epi pathway of this is really interesting and totally nonsensical. And I'm super confused how the monkey is giving some people one strain and then others this strain. And it's, we'll never know. It's really fascinating, but I wish it was so simple.
Yeah, I mean, like, maybe in the heads of the writer, he's like, actually, he had this really complex, systematic, multi-species interaction pathway. And he was like, I need to reduce this to one likable monkey character. And so basically, what would have been multi-generational, multiple populations was basically, no, it's a simple story about a cute monkey.
It was a really cute monkey.
Did the monkey die? I can't remember. Spoiler alert, if you've not seen this, you know, in the past 20 years, it's been out.
They don't tell you the outcome of the monkey, but I also remembered, and I didn't really watch the show much growing up, but I remember this one episode of Friends when they're filming an Outbreak 2 in New York City. And that same monkey, because obviously it's a character acting monkey, is in that. He's Ross's pet monkey, Marcel. And he's going to be in Outbreak 2. And I was just like,
yes,
this is amazing. I want to know the plotline of Outbreak 2. But I think it's, yeah, I thought that was that whole thing was really, really fascinating and very confusing. And I would tell you, I'd be super curious to hear more. I feel like if you gave some virologists, especially some, you know, working in hemorrhagic fevers, because I harassed one of my good friends and colleagues, Dr. Angela Rasmussen, who's a virologist who works specifically in, you know, filoviruses and host response. And was like, outside of rage, what are your feelings on this? And it bubbled down. It was like, no, this is like, yeah, a super infection can occur, but no, just no. Bad directors, bad continuity.
There's things like soup, there's ideas like superhosts that are immune. These ideas come up a lot. So the thing that can keep, so you have an incredibly lethal, dangerous disease, which is a film because it's so deadly, but randomly you have usually a main attractive character who is completely immune for some reason because they licked a battery or something at some point in the past 5 minutes. And then
Matt Damon
usually
in Contagion.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Usually a host, and that host is very often portrayed as usually some sort of like ne'er-do-well. Often the ne'er-do-well character brings in the disease. It's a weird, it happens all the time. And that person, it usually is messily ill, kills everyone. And so it's, and then other times you have the super host, the unknowing super host as well.
Yeah.
And I find that interesting, these kind of caricatures that you see in different films.
I think one thing too is like the intermediary like species, right? So, and this is kind of a thing that's really fascinating that has been a big topic with COVID, that you didn't really see an Outbreak, but you definitely see in Contagion, is, you know, you have the host. And that animal, in this case, gave the disease versus having an intermediary species, you know, where if normally the host, if we're going to go with kind of what this, I think Outbreak was really based, obviously, on Ebola or Marburg. So in that case, you know, we're assuming hosts are normally bats, and then intermediary species are non-human primates. And that's where the human spillover event occurs. There was none of that. It was just like host causes the issue straight through. So it's like, all right, you really committed to this monkey being the central focus of this film.
Apparently it was a contractual thing.
Question.
So apparently initially
it was a choice.
It was a choice. And the point was that the monkey was big on kind of what he was expecting financially. It was obviously a big name.
He gets residuals. I'm sure he still gets residuals to this day. I would love it.
And so that was part of the reason, I think it was going to be quite a complex nuance. Oh, don't worry about the monkey, it makes sense type explanation. But this monkey kind of made his role bigger and bigger and bigger in that film. Like, he was a real diva, apparently. That's what happened.
He had demands.
He had very serious demands. So before we move on to Contagion, there's a few other things in Outbreak that, of course,
I have so many thoughts. Just so you're aware, I have like 2 pages of rage thoughts on just this film.
So, a couple of things that I found interesting. Killing it with fire. This seems to be quite this idea takes hold pretty quick. Mm-hmm. And of course, there's no storyline reasons for it. What I particularly enjoyed was the whole reason they were having to kill it with fire was the fact that it didn't work killing it with fire where the outbreak originally came from, that this was seen as I guess it was like a hangover from like nuclear total destruction type doom idea.
It is. I mean, I think here's the thing that I find personally really funny. So they're like, we're going to carpet bomb the town. We know the host animal's out there, right? And if everything came from this cute little, capuchin monkey but they're not worried any other interactions that monkey's had with people being out in the wild at all. Like, once the town is carpet bombed, we're done.
Yeah. I mean,
we're done. And also, we're good.
Purely kind of sort of meta commentary or narrative, like that monkey's looking for a sequel. There's no getting around it. Like, he want that, we've always mentioned this. He's crying out for
agenda. Deal, see it.
Yeah. Deal
he's
with
got
the
shifty little eyes.
Yeah. And
he's
so
demanding.
He is demanding. So yeah, that I didn't understand. I didn't understand that. Now, the other issue, of course, was the finding the treatment. So the nice, interesting backstory about this, which is kind of, as someone who was interested in history of biological warfare, I found quite interesting, was the fact that apparently this was a kind of weapon, or at least it was an agent that had been weaponized by nature and then refined as this kind of secret back of the US's pocket.
They want to keep it.
And a really helpful one, of course, because nothing would be more helpful as a biological weapon than something that you could release and then couldn't control. In fact, it would be guaranteed to spread to everyone. You couldn't get the vaccine out too quick enough. And as we know, getting vaccines out to a domestic population, even the military, is always quick.
So easy.
And painless.
So easy, right? Oh my gosh, yeah.
So that was interesting. So part of the reason they were firebombing the town was so that nobody else found out about this disease. Not that firebombing a town would draw any attention to this issue globally, or perhaps motivate many other people to get involved in finding what it was all about. I mean, I don't.
It's so fascinating because they even showed reporters. There's a scene where they're showing reporters all along the town, the whole boxed off area. And I'm kind of like, how are you going to totally get everyone to ignore the fact they have a massive, like, C-130 flying in to drop a bomb on a coastal city in the U.S. Like, aside from all of the just legal aspects of that, but okay, that seems like a little bit of an overreaction, just a smidge, but sure, let's go along with that and ignore the fact that they're secretly keeping it as a biological weapon, despite the fact that at this point, it was like, 1997, I think? And the first scene that they show was in 67, right? And they were saying Zaire, which from what I recall, it wasn't called Zaire at that point.
Hey, but again, this was part of the reason to mask the issue with the monkey casting. So they didn't want to make it too specific where it was.
Let's not get technical. We would be doing a disservice if we talk fast.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. It's true.
But like, I think it's so interesting because okay, so 67, and then at this point, what year was the film? Was it 93?
I've got it here. 95? On my TV screen. It is.
But either way, we're 1995. Well into being compliant. Okay, we're well into being compliant with the BWC, but we're still keeping this. We're still holding on to it.
Of course, the US never kept anything past a formal declaration in the early years. We'll come back to that perhaps. But the point is that, generally speaking,
I'm not touching that.
Generally speaking, what we can definitely say is the idea of the US having an interest in a large, indiscriminate biological weapon that was been held against some adversary, we don't know. I mean, that is hours of fun, but there's actually not enough there to critique it. So I'm going to have to think about how I would.
Yeah.
It was like
a whisper of a subplot. I thought it was really fascinating, considering the big aspect of that that's like, holy crap, you're literally talking about us intentionally keeping this in USAMRID and actively by, there's just too much. But it was just kind of like a sprinkle of conspiracy right there.
I mean, the one thing that I think was we can be grateful for, of course, was that despite that resolute commitment to Moabbing this town, which was done with security phrases and passwords, and it was the highest level of kind of
clean sweep
activation.
Operation clean sweep.
Yeah. The one weakness of that was the fact that the plane could not divert 6 to 7 foot around its pre-mapped flight route in. So, I'm not an expert in military aviation, I would say I'm far from an expert. I don't even dabble in kind of rules and behaviors around military engagements. I assume our militaries cannot be overcome by someone parking in the wrong place. That is not enough to completely undermine a plan. It always falls apart. But in that film, that was the...
There's so much at stake in this film. And I think there were a lot of questions, and that was definitely one of them. I was really shocked by that. But I was actually also very impressed with the fact that like half of the people, the military folks in the town doing control and response, were in PPE and half weren't. I thought that was a choice. It was really fascinating to be like driving through the town of, you know, potentially infectious people with now a quote unquote airborne disease with the windows down.
Yeah.
You know, why not? Why? And they're screaming, and half the soldiers have masks on, half don't. And so, sure, we can't divert the plane, you know, 6 to 7 feet the other way, but I'm not an expert. So.
No, I mean, it was strange. I thought there could have been definitely other ways. I mean, I guess the guy running in, Dustin running in and being like, stop the planes, that wouldn't, on the ground, wouldn't have worked. They'd have literally just firebombed him. There was no, that was not ambiguous about that happening.
Oh, my question though too is like, why did they have to drop the bomb at all? Was it like pre, you know, calculated in? Because they still dropped it over water, but if you're going to go out of your way and intentionally drop it in the wrong location to avoid killing, why drop it all?
I think that was them being like, oh, because that was the pilot's defense, wasn't it? Being like, oh, we tried to drop it, whoops, but a bit of wind shear must have caught it.
The wind, yeah.
These things happen. The killing.
There was a flock of seagulls.
Yeah.
Well, whoops.
I mean, that also is a point. So if they ever come against a swan in that kind of delivery type setup, they would have to abort the mission instantly because they couldn't divert, or basically go through the swan, fingers crossed, and just hope for the best.
Black swan.
But yeah, black swan events. There we go. The kill it with fire thing, I also don't quite understand.
Yeah.
Let's just, for a moment.
I mean, fire kills everything. Like, we autoclave things to sterilize, but that's heat. That's not flame.
Obviously fire is just like, so a Moab is just a big autoclave. They're directly relatable. They're like the same thing, right?
Sure.
I mean, if anything, I've seen autoclaves marketed as little Moabs. That's what they're sold as like their kind of, you know, their brand. Is that true? No?
Is that like the little, like, yeah, the little, like, what's the little easy bake oven?
Yeah.
That's the new easy bake
it's
oven.
It's the easy bake oven. They're entirely, as concepts, fire, autoclaves, entirely interchangeable. Functionally, in fact, we discovered the autoclave before fire, when the Stone Age was happening. So that...
I get behind us.
Yeah, thank you. My history of sort of large-scale environmental decontamination isn't comprehensive, probably fair to say. But...
Same.
I think one of the first things you'd hear about if you were studying large-scale open-air contamination were the type of examples where you could discuss setting fire to huge areas to clear pathogens. And I can't recall to this any examples. Now, ironically, one of the myths that persists from the plague in the Britain was that somehow the Great Fire of London got rid of the mm-hmm. got rid of the you know, was part of the reason.
Oh, yeah. I like this.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it makes complete sense because as we know as well, the UK is all of London and all rats only live in London. That's where they don't go out of zone three. Like, that doesn't happen. So if there is a major fire in London, that would result in every single rat dying. But that's often talked about as kind of the reasons that the Black Death...
Well, this is also... Well, yeah, like the Pope would sit between two like massive, you know, I don't want to say fireplaces, but I remember reading during the Black Death, you know, at one point, one of the popes was sitting behind two massive statues with fire coming out of them or giant candles, whatever it was. But the whole thing was fire. Fire equals safety from disease, apparently. And that's an interesting choice for this film, I think, because I don't, and I would be super curious if we're going to go down the hypothetical route, what the strategy would have been if it didn't mutate to quote unquote airborne. Like if we were just dealing with, you know, run of the mill viral hemorrhagic fever that spread mostly through contact with bodily fluids, like do you still carpet bomb?
Because the people would have been the issue, right? I mean, my geography is not great. Where's the town that this is set in? Because this is screaming like
it's in California.
So this is screaming isolation island to me. I mean, unfortunately.
Yes.
My knowledge of California extends basically to things covered in the film The Rock. So, of course, Alcatraz would have been too small.
Fair.
Would have been too small for that entire population to be sent to. Plus,
that
obviously,
would be too easy.
I mean, at that time, I think they were actually literally probably still filming The Rock around this sort of time. So it would have been really awkward crossover.
It's a really beautiful period in film. Can I just say that? Like between The Rock and Outbreak. Really love it. It's a thing of beauty.
I think for me, The Rock and Outbreak are the archetypes of chemical, biological, disaster type films. I mean, they are, I think, really important, really important. So we'll remember something we haven't mentioned about Outbreak in a few moments' time, I'm sure, and interrupt ourselves. But let's move on to Contagion.
I have one thing I have to say, though, because it is super annoying to me.
Yeah.
The way that they show BSL-4. So they did a good job of trying to be like, this is the difference between biosafety levels.
Oh, at the beginning, they have the walkthrough, don't they? Like, they have really cool...
Which is super cool, except they're not fully closed. So once you get to, like, BSL-3 and BSL-4, it seemed like people were just able to easily pass through. But I just want to throw out there, what cracks me up so much is that in the spacesuits, the BSL-4 suits, those are positive pressure. So air is blowing out. So if you get a rip, it's intentionally designed that it's not just going to suck in all of this air. So when, you know, the character of Casey, oh my gosh, why can't I remember that actor's name?
Kevin Spacey.
So when he rips his suit and he's like, suddenly gets Motaba, California strain. It's just so interesting because, like, yes, that is a potential thing, but I'm like, the way you guys are showing some of these BSL levels is really fascinating. Like, they don't use glass in BSL-4. You know what I mean? Like, they're not going to, when you're doing a hot post-mortem, you're not going to be handing someone a scalpel like that. You're going to be handing a tray so they can pick it up. And it was just, I just found all the infection control stuff really interesting. I was like, oh my God, even a hospital HVAC system doesn't look like that. I digress.
Because wasn't there
to the peaceful place?
Yeah, there's a parallel scene. We were not doing The Rock today, but in the one where basically it fails inside, and all of a sudden they haven't got the negative air or something, or the sprays or something, and you're kind of like, yeah. I mean, imagine that if like before you trained to go into BSL-4, you watched that, and they were like, this is basically what the safety systems we have in place are. So just beware of these.
Yeah.
Like, though, I mean, if this film had been set 20, 30, 40 years before, then actually, I mean, some of the stuff that happens in these films actually isn't too far from what we saw in certain, you know, biodefense research institutions in various parts of the world. They've all got their own unique, beautiful histories in this regard, whether that be with tularemia, or even airborne pathogens, where you've occasionally had incidents of things getting lost, escaping, being transported in not the most appropriate way. And so for me, that's interesting, is the fact that some of the...
I hear
these things. But certainly, if that had been set 50 years previously, perhaps some of the issues, mm-hmm. you would have gone, well, actually, I have seen that done. So I thought that was quite
interesting. Yeah, that is special. It was a choice. I'm not going to lie. I would love to know who their scientific advisors were on it, because Contagion had scientific advisors. They had like senior, and then, because most films, when they're dealing with a certain amount, I mean, even we have a lot of military advisors on films. So for Contagion, they had, you know, three senior advisors. I know it was, you know, Mark Lipsitch, Larry Brilliant, and I think Lori Garrett, and then they had other technical advisors. So I would be so curious, like, who was the technical advisor, if there was one, on Outbreak? And like, who did you hate so much? Why were you so angry?
I had a look. This is a classical thing. The character acting monkey managed to squeeze his brother in. And so he had it. He basically got him in. And so he did the scientific communication. Was very good on unicycles. Wasn't actually trained in epidemiology, but, you know.
There we go.
Diva.
There we go. That'll do it.
So Diva. Contagion.
A groundbreaking ceremony for a new factory.
Did she mention seeing anyone who was sick? Anyone on a plane at the airport?
No, she said she was jet lagged.
The average person touches their face 3 to 5 times every waking minute. In between, we're touching doorknobs, water fountains, and each other.
Beth! Go up to your room, honey.
So we have a virus with no treatment protocol and no vaccine at this time.
You had a seizure this morning, Beth.
Do you have a history of seizures?
No.
Allergies?
As of last night, there were 32 cases.
Unfortunately, she did die.
Right. Can I go talk to her?
Mr. Amoff, your wife is dead.
What are you talking about? Okay. What happened to her? What happened to her?
Is there any way someone could weaponize the bird flu? Is that what we're looking at?
Someone doesn't have to weaponize the bird flu. The birds are doing that.
Watch this. It's transmission, so we just need to know which direction.
On day one, there were 2 people, and then 4, and then 16. In 3 months, it's 1 billion. That's where we're headed.
They're calling out the National Guard. They're moving the president underground.
People will panic.
Get away!
It will tip over.
The truth is being kept from the world.
Cook your samples, destroy everything.
Hello. I need you to get me the names of everyone who serviced this room. It's an emergency.
You can't panic now.
I know.
I'm gonna get you home.
I got people too, Dr. Cheever. We all do.
Don't talk to anyone. Don't touch anyone. Stay away from other people.
Defend
in
your car!
We're not sick! This is figuring us out faster than we're figuring it out.
It's mutating.
Let's just remind ourselves of the cast of Contagion, because I forgot how huge it was. But also...
Well, Soderbergh, that's like his thing. These big, you know,
so let's
big cast. Anyway,
let's do the list of the roll call of names. So first of all, we have Matt Damon heading up the list, embodied, according to Wikipedia, as the kind of everyman of the film, just trying to protect his family and exposed to bits and pieces, the human face of the consequence of the supervirus, that big.
And the immune. He's our immune human face, which is its whole can of...
Because I guess the film would have been shorter. I guess if you're going to have a character with a human empathy part, either they're having to live somewhere very remotely and not dealing with the other humans, or they only appear for like 4 minutes in the film and then they're dead. Lawrence Fishburne as Dr. Ellis Cheever. Jude Law. Now, love Jude Law. Handsome fella. For me,
I do.
as a character, I struggled with his performance in that. No aspersion on him as an actor, but I just, the character made very little sense to me. But we can come back to that. Kate Winslet, headline role in that, more ways than one. And then, of course, we had various other supporting actors who were excellent throughout. So, remind us of the plot of the film Contagion. And just to reiterate, this was 10 years before COVID. So, which is interesting. So, confession, when I watched this, I didn't bother to check what year it came out. So, I hadn't seen it before. And I was like, oh, this is a bit on my nose. And I was like, oh, no, it was before. So you can get away with it because it was before the catastrophe. So it's okay. Carry on. So the plot.
Look, in full honesty, most Epis and public health and ID people actually really do like this movie because it got a lot right and they did a good job. So basically, we have an outbreak. And I think what's interesting about this is it's really looking at US response, but also WHO and global response to this novel pathogen that really originates out of China. And it's, I know it's a little on the nose right now. And it's, I think the scary thing about this is that it has a high mortality rate. So you're literally looking at the moment of transmission. And what I think is so great about this is at the very end of the film, they actually go back and you see, in my opinion, probably the most pivotal moment, which is spillover. So they're dealing with MEV, which is this like meningoencephalitis virus, which is actually modeled after Nipah virus. And I think the mortality rate they say at one point is like 20%, 30%. And you're looking at an outbreak literally from how the CDC handles it, how WHO handles it. There's questions about, is it a biological weapon? And, you know, Jude Law's character, I think, is a really important one given what we experienced with COVID. But I love this movie. It literally came out right when I finished my MPH in Epi and started my career as an epidemiologist. And I was just like mesmerized by it. And now I think it's even more poignant because there's a lot of things that it didn't cover that we probably should have, but the fact that they touched on spillover and human encroachment on, you know, on wildlife and just like ecological disruption, deforestation, like all of that, I think is so sad. But yeah, I could go on. I love that movie.
It was like, I mean, it was incredibly emotionally charged from the outset in how it was done. And I thought that was kind of really clever in terms of, and you kind of, to some extent, you had a bit of a whodunit in there as well in terms of how it's spreading, who's patient zero. This thing always, so I guess in very small localized outbreaks, patient zero, like, I'm using the right word, right? Is a thing, like who in this kind of group of people.
So we actually don't use patient zero. It's actually not really an accurate term. Yeah. I mean, we use it, but it's not an accurate term. I think we really go back to what's called index case, which is the first case essentially. Yeah. So in this case, the index case was, you know, they're kind of trying to figure out in the casino scene, who was it? Was it Gwyneth Paltrow's character who, you know, to the point we mentioned earlier, like they did so much advertising around her and then they killed her right away. Spoiler alert. Sorry, everyone. She's our index case. But they're using surveillance footage to show, because they have a second and a third case. So you have, you know, these kind of multiple generations of cases. And they're trying to see which way. Was she the first one? Was she the second? And lo and behold, it's our Gwyneth Paltrow. I did find it really interesting that the two cases in the U.S., is, you know, she's bringing it home from a business trip in China. The two cases in the US are a result of infidelity. I was like, okay, there's some judgment and there's some ethics, you know, some punishment going on there. Like, and we're going to kill her right away. And then we're going to kill the guy the voice is actually Steven Soderbergh, which cracks me up.
It's quite common in disaster films, though. You often have that idea of like, so I think Jurassic Park is a classic one where you're like, you know that person's on the make and they're a wrong one. Mm-hmm. And you think, mm-hmm. mate, you're getting velociraptors before you realize it. In fact, it was a scary thing, wasn't it, that got him? The guy with the big glasses. Yeah. The insurance guy.
Who runs to the bathroom. Yeah, who leaves all the kids. Yep. You're like, oh, you're going to die.
Yeah, he's gone, mate. He's gone. And yeah, that's, but certainly that's interesting. I mean, I do like that, not to get too academic on it, but I do enjoy the fact that many of these kind of tropes that feel they should be there have always been there in cinema, mm-hmm. and obviously go back a long way before that. It's really cool. So the one thing that stuck with me was that obviously in a lot of films around diseases and stuff, there's basically the idea, a bit like the kind of how does the flying machine work? It's like, oh, don't worry about that. It's fine. Like So
it's the deus ex machina, right? We're in an insolvable problem. So we have to throw something in there, and obviously it works.
Yeah. And so in this one, though, I thought what was really good is the fact that they actually did take the time in parts to give seasoned professionals lectures in Epidemiology 101, which I really enjoyed. So it wasn't just the scientists talking to the politician to explain the basics. Even when the epidemiologists got together, they made sure that they both understood some of the elemental aspects of epidemiology, and I quite enjoyed that. So what sticks in your mind in terms of the types of concepts they brought to the dialogue from epidemiology?
I mean, I love that they mentioned RNA, right? So, you know, that's the reproductive rate. And I think the one thing that I was a little bummed to see is that when Kate Winslet's character is teaching a little bit of that for the local, I think she puts like measles and polio on there, and both are knots for those. I remember being pretty low when they're actually much higher in real life. And the one thing about, you know, are knots is that you have kind of like the reproductive number, and then you have like, so that's the basic. So that's, we have no control mechanisms. You have everyone's susceptible, you know, and it's bad. Like that is as bad as it's likely going to get. But then you have the effective reproductive number, and that's when you do have some level of immunity and some interventions in place. And I wish you would have mentioned that, simply because, you know, at some point our knots change. They're constantly evolving. Every single little outbreak and cluster is different. So an R knot is not like this kind of stagnant number. And I love that she talked about it, but I wish she would have gone on to like, hey, if we actually close the schools and if we actually implement masks, then we can bring that number down potentially. That would have, I think, been a better selling point for non-public health people that don't, because, you know, that politician, or, you know, I think she was a local government official, was like, well, if we close the schools, who's going to take care of the kids? It's the holiday seasons. We can't close the malls, et cetera. All valid points. And especially when you're dealing with like a totally novel situation that you don't know.
I was half expecting a kind of old looking general guy, kind of, who should have been retired, to kind of go, have you considered killing him with fire? But that didn't happen this time. Yeah, they moved on in the Hollywood world of disease response. They had at least moved on from carpet bombing, which was,
they're expanding. You know, we're getting better at the writing. We're getting better.
The trajectory is there. The trajectory is there. So, I mean, obviously, the way that the disease was seen to transmit was interesting. There was a lot of emphasis mm-hmm. placed on fomite transmission early on, which made a lot of sense. In fact, that was actually quite spooky, because like the washing your hands thing was something that would actually be advice we see later on in a few years' time.
Yeah.
But in the universal rule of all films involving pathogens is at some point, not only should they become aerially transmissible, they should do it in both a dramatic way, a way that can be somehow visually depicted on the screen, and also happen instantly, and all of a sudden it's just everywhere. And so let's talk a bit about that.
I think it's really interesting. So again, this, from everything I understand, this, you know, MEV virus was really based off of Nipah. And Nipah is really transmitted, you know, more so by consuming contaminated foods, interacting with bodily fluids, you know, of infected animals, but also really of people who are, you know, taking care of other people. So it's not, when we say airborne, I think people think like long range, like measles. You can be in the same like large building. And with this, it was a little interesting because I interpreted it more as like droplet or close, you know, droplet and aerosol, but more close contact. So it has to be with the fomites, the bodily fluids, and just closer contact. And which I thought was also really fascinating because the use of PPE, so masks especially, was so indiscriminate. It was all over the place. Like no one in the CDC was wearing a mask, which is super bizarre to me. And totally against what they normally, what their normal protocols are. I mean, everyone either was working remotely during COVID or you were wearing a mask when you came in. But what I also thought was super interesting, they were doing these interviews with sick people and no one was wearing eye protection.
Yeah.
So I was just like, okay. So it was a little like they got a lot right and they were emphasizing masks and respiratory protection and, you know, environmental contamination, all great things. But I thought the use of masks was all over the place, and especially by people who you know would have been consistently doing it. In fact, yes. There was a scene where someone's wearing a respirator that has no filters on it. I'm like, cool. All right, who is our continuity person? Where's our props master? Get in there. You guys know better than that. But it was really interesting. I thought, so yeah, like good and bad.
And like imagine directing it. I mean, it's part of the reason you never see many gas masks in World War II films. Not only the fact that it wasn't used, but the fact that like, you don't want, like, if you're paying £1 billion for, you know, I was going to make the World Trade character acted monkey joke again, but I won't. I'll leave it. But if you've got an important line you're giving in a film, even if you're giving it a BSL-4 lab, you don't want them in a mask. And you want the face out yeah. there. And that's part of the rule. Yeah. So these guys, you know, these actors, the major casts, were like kind of, they were conforming to the standards of their professional role until he or her had to deliver a killer line. And at that point, you don't have to wear the mask anymore because as we know, like that can overcome the threat of infection if you've got hot, important things to say.
100%. You know. Well, and the funny part to me too is like, look, if you've, and I'm, you know, being in the UK, I'm sure you appreciate it. When you're wearing an N95 mask and it's cold out, that mask becomes saturated so quickly. And since this all started, I think the main characters were in, was it Minnesota, I want to say, in the winter? Like, you're going to be changing masks left and right because that mask is going to get so saturated with moisture. But it's, yeah, I thought the transmission stuff was interesting, especially if it was so fomite. How did more people in the airport not get it? Because the first scene is Gwyneth Paltrow coughing, visibly sick, in the airport, eating peanuts, on an airplane. And I'm just like, if this is as transmissible as like everyone else is getting it, okay, there's got to be another case or two at least related to travel. And there's no healthcare worker transmission as a result of her being hospitalized. Like that part, I wish they would have touched on a little bit more because it was basically saying only her son and her, you know, like side piece got sick when we all know it would have been far more than that.
So the other thing that I was interested in, and this of course also speaks back to Outbreak, is the idea of a hunt for a cure and a hunt for a treatment and the timeline. So this disease was, it's kind of as if they made it as terrible as possible at the beginning. And then they were like, oh, it got too far. And we had to work out a way of bringing it back. Cause if not, it's basically a snuff film and everyone's dead. So we have to like, so in the film, I get confused. Was it serum based this one as well, where they have like somebody with a serum of it? I can't remember. How do they go about finding the...
I actually don't think they talk about that too much, how they develop it. And it's not like monoclonal antibodies. I know that they're testing it and she actually develops, you know, she injects herself with the vaccine and visits her dad in the hospital. And this is probably one of the bigger pieces in the film that a lot of people have noted is the most inaccurate, just the timeline for vaccine development, because they do such a good job showing the days, you know, like day 27, day 129. All of this happens, I think, way faster than we would think. But the development of that vaccine, and it was like 120 days or something, that's... For a novel pathogen, especially if it's something that's, you know, rivaling Nipah virus, like, come on, we don't have a vaccine for that. So it's, I think that's a little unrealistic. And even more so, the way they did the delivery system was crazy to me. So there's no prioritization then for healthcare workers. Yeah, it was the dual nostril. And then there was a lottery. And I'm super curious that there was not even a second to talk about vaccine hesitancy, which we know is a huge issue during COVID.
So of course that was, I guess, talked about a bit by the guy, because of course the main thing of Jude was like, he's like, oh, you know, this is going to favor the, yeah, yeah. And it's kind of, that was kind of, and again, the character was
pharmacy and stuff. Yeah.
So maybe that's the thing where I was like, that character annoyed me the whole way through, but maybe it was literally supposed to be kind of like a pastiche on this kind of a character that would annoy me normally anyway. But the delivery, the way they decided how to give stuff out was, I thought, fantastic. Of course, we know in reality, they wouldn't use a lottery. It'd be based on ability to pay, which is a much fairer system.
You know what's crazy, though? Watching this, I haven't watched this actually since COVID, which is crazy. But the one thing that, you know, now watching in hindsight is like, they didn't talk about testing at all. There was no testing. No one talks about testing at all. It's this really fascinating thing. And I'm like, whoa. And it's actually so foreboding if you think about it, given that testing was one of the biggest issues, at least in the US, that we faced. So it's kind of this perfect, like, oh no, we thought we would just have this in the bag. We're good.
Though, of course, I mean, testing was not necessarily that useful, because onset of symptoms rage, sometimes it could be a matter of 2 or 3 hours and they were all of a sudden spluttering and coughing. And so, It was his own test. You basically were walking around test paper, because you told you instantly you got it, and you're, unless
100%,
unless you were working really hard, and then it might be ambiguous about if you're just a bit overworked or if you have been exposed. So that is true, but testing wasn't true.
If you're Matt Damon and you have the original strain of a disease we know nothing about, and then you're considered immune for the entire duration of this pandemic, and you get your immunity band, and that's it. We're totally cool for just letting you out into the wild after you've had the novel infectious disease and we don't understand anything about immunity. But you're Matt Damon, obviously. Like, you're trustworthy. You wear a sweater vest. You're fine.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely fine. Of course, in both films, in the Outbreak and this one, the idea of quarantine with extreme prejudice, I liked a lot. But also, I very much enjoyed the way people were, we locked down the city. Like, that sort of idea is really interesting, and how that would have been policed and worked.
Although I'm gonna give Contagion some credit, because they actually took the time to really differentiate between isolation and quarantine, which was a huge annoyance for me during COVID. But they also, you know, we're locking down states, but we're not talking about how every single state in the US was doing something different. And like state public health laws, which now we're pulling back a lot on in the US and limiting public health authority. So that's a tough pill to swallow while watching this.
So to bring us to the, I guess we'll try and keep this under the hour for the sake of our listeners. But I guess before we go, I guess it'd be worth, what, talk me through some of your recent watches and films you would recommend people go. I mean, I would still recommend people go see these films. Again, they are, I enjoy them on many levels. Is there anything you've been watching recently that you would recommend that you've really enjoyed?
In terms of infectious diseases or like bioweapons?
Yeah, why not?
Oof. I mean, look, one of the films that I personally don't think gets enough credit is Carriers. I love that movie. It's like an apocalyptic virus movie where it is dark. It's Chris Pine before he got popular on Star Trek, and everyone dies. There's no cure. There is like 100% fatality, I think, for this virus. And I just kind of love it. I think they do a really interesting job with it, and it's fun to watch. So highly recommend that. I got a little frustrated watching the Hot Zone mini series that was done. They really tried hard, but like, it hurts. It hurts a lot on certain pieces. I'm a fan of a zombie movie, so I love me a good World War Z, Last of Us, but there's so many good ones, you know, Like even the first season of Jack Ryan, they were going to weaponize Ebola. Like what? We're just going to dig up a corpse in West Africa. I don't remember what country they were in. We're going to dig it up because it's totally, you know, they're just going to bury them like 3 feet below soil. And we're going to somehow weaponize Ebola, which it's not like countries haven't tried before. And just, you know, it's really hard to do. Yeah. There's a lot of different ones.
The one I saw recently, which was unexpected, I think quite often it happens when you put a film on or a series on, sitting with your partner, and all of a sudden you realize there is a biological or disease subplot you hadn't expected. I'm not quite sure. This is either going to make this excellent or it's ruined it for me, and I'm going to have to stop listening. I guess it depends on what day of the week it is, usually. But what I saw recently, unexpected one was Black Crab, which is a Swedish film, which I think it's on Netflix. And that is basically a lot of ice skating in like a post-apocalyptical landscape, but there's a big biological weapon type dimension to it. And so I would recommend that one, if only for like the machine guns on ice type vibe, which, you know, it's underdone.
I personally think if you're doing fight choreography in a film, we need more machine guns on ice skates, but just saying.
Yeah, I think that's a wonderful point to end on, really. I'm sure we can all agree on. Well, thank you so much for coming on today. And thank you to our listeners who have bared with us as we've tried to navigate a new format and way of doing things. And hopefully the product we get at the end will be of some interest to those listening out there. But thank you very much for coming on. And I look forward to continuing to follow your work on Twitter and so on. Have you got anything to plug at the moment that you've been up to?
Oh gosh. I mean, ironically, you know, we actually just have a new report that's come out on spillover, the ecological and biological security dynamics of spillover research. So I would say check that out. But then thank you so much for having me. This was so much fun. I mean, truly my favorite things are films and infectious diseases. So getting to nerd out about it was a huge honor, especially on a podcast that I love.
Thank you very much. You're very welcome. And that is our show for today. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope you've enjoyed it. Please do send me your thoughts, rants, and suggestions for future guests and films. I'm inexplicably back on X and also contactable via LinkedIn and email. And if this is your first episode, do subscribe to hear future episodes and drop the show a review, as I'm always eager for feedback. And hey, it helps more people find the show. We'll be right back.